You're listening to the Truth Frequency Radio Network.
No hate, no hype, no fear.
Straight to you from a spaceship currently building some pyramid-type structures in what is now Egypt. You didn't think the pharaohs actually did that, did you? Hello, everyone, and welcome to Strange World, where the truth is often stranger than fiction. I'm your host, Mark Sargent, the creator of Flat Earth Glues, which propose that all of us are living inside a Truman Show enclosed structure thousands of miles wide. Check it out at enclosedworld.com or just Google Flat Earth Clues. If you can't find it, your internet is probably down because of that megastorm that's heading up towards Vancouver right now, which is home of Orphan Red, and heading down my way towards Seattle. My good friend and personal wingman for the show is Jonathan from Jersey. What's going on, man?
What's going on, man?
Yeah, you know, trying to get through a show, and I wasn't kidding about the storm.
I read that earlier. That I said it was going to hit Vancouver, so I guess that's close to you.
Yeah, that's just up the road. In fact, I could get to Vancouver, and if I drove fast, and maybe just a little over an hour.
Oh, right on.
Yeah, so that's really close. But yeah, it's windy here. You know, things are whipping around, and the power blinked while we were doing our pre-show. So, which meant my router reset. So, if anyone's listening, and we run into any problems. Please bear with us. I will probably be dropped, and worst case scenario, I will call in on my cell phone, which has a lousy connection from the island I'm on up here, and Jonathan will pick me up, and maybe we can keep this thing going.
Right. It's just like when Kirk gets stuck on a planet.
And then, he has to phone in the radio show?
And then somebody, yeah, he tries to get the uplink, and I'll take care of the ship.
This would literally be the definition of phoning it in.
Yeah, there you go.
I actually would be phoning in my own show, which would be ridiculous. So, anyway, so what'd you do this weekend? Anything fun?
Well, I tried brushing up on my flat Earth facts, and I started watching videos and everything because I'd asked you for a long time. Like, you know, it's not that I haven't taken interest in this or done any research. It's just that I don't do as much as you.
Yeah.
And now I'm starting to get asked more and more questions, and still I defer back to you. I say, look, I'm not the expert on this. But it's not that I'm stupid. It's just that I'm lazy, or, you know, I've just been busy with other
it's
things
not that
here.
I'm stupid. I'm just lazy. That's fantastic. He's not single, ladies.
Fat, drunk, and stupid is no way to go through life, son.
Animal House reference. Yeah. Priceless.
But no, I figured, okay, I should research it out. And so I started going down a list like you told me, like math, Eric, you know, all these videos, Jaronism, and I started going through them all. But then I put Eric's name in, and I guess he has an International Flat Earth Society?
Yeah, the International Flat Earth Research Society, also known as IFERS, I-F-E-R-S.
Yeah, so I go there, and there's a ton of information. And I'm going through, and it's like any other forum I've ever been on. I mean, conspiracy forums for the past 20 years, and it's your typical click. You know, you could see who's the admin, who posts ad nauseum, who has no life.
Yeah.
And so I was like, okay, this would be a cool group because these people are like really seriously into it. Mm-hmm. I join with my real name because I always put my real name. I don't do facades on screen names.
Yeah.
And as I'm putting my avatar up, well, the screen goes white. It says you're banned from this forum. I was like, wow. I was like, this thing's worse than Godlike Productions. I mean, not only did I not know what I posted, but I didn't even post anything yet. I think maybe I just put one post like, hey, I'm new here. I was like, I'm looking for for information. I'm looking to research. So I don't know if it's because it's, me, Jonathan, and I'm affiliated with you.
Oh, I'd say that was a pretty safe bet.
Yeah, but it's like, what effing, like, and I'm looking at the YouTube video, and I was like, what an effing hypocrite. I was like, here's somebody who says he's, the leader of the flat earth, whatever. He started all this, or he's done all this research, and he encourages others to go to that website, IEFRS, whatever it is. Yeah. And I followed the instructions. And just like most things, when, you mix it together, it never tastes like the box says or like mom makes. And so I didn't get that far.
Yeah.
I got booted.
It's ridiculous. But as you know, power corrupts. Sometimes it is good to be king, but other times not so much. And yeah, you're absolutely right. Well, yeah, Jaron Rand did the same thing you did. He got on there and he was trying to be real nice. But the second he didn't say anything bad about me, he got torched.
Well, right? And I'll say this much. I saw that too. Like I went into the one, because they have it in different categories. It's a good bulletin board setup.
Yeah. Yeah.
And the one was like, and then there's your name and Jaronism's name and Patricia's name. And then it's like, it's funny because you read the first thread, I guess the original page, and then you go to the last, and what a difference. And like, and you try to like figure out where crap went wrong in the middle somewhere.
Yeah.
It's like, holy crap, when did this all go downhill?
Yeah.
So with Jaronism, it was all like, hey, man, I love your stuff. It's like, great stuff. And he's posting, and I'm reading through it. What I always do is when I go into a forum, I read the first page, get the gist of it, and then I go to the end because, there's too much time that goes on and it's a lot of it's superfluous crap. Mm-hmm. But then all of a sudden it's like, oh, the guy's a traitor. He's this and that. And I'm like, what the hell happened? And sure enough, back up to like page 8 or 9, there's Eric saying, well, because he went on TFR, he went on your show. All of a sudden, he's a shill. That effing word, shill. It's like I think every time I hear the word shill, I think of that line from The Princess Bride. He's like, I do not think that word means what you think it means.
What you think it means.
Yeah, it's like they misuse it.
Inconceivable.
And so, Patricia, the same thing. And it's like, and I'm like, well, I didn't see my name in there, but I'm sure now that I'm airing my aggravation on air, I'll get my own little niche.
He's run into some real, he's got to be careful, to be honest, because not necessarily from me, because I'm not going to come out and necessarily torch him, but he's got to be careful as far as, because at this point people say, oh no, he's going to bring down the movement, he's going to tear down the movement. It's like, no, he's not, because there's too many other voices at this point. Forget about just me. There's, even when he made his enemies list some months ago, the amount of people that are in this thing now making flat earth videos far exceeds his work. And he's got to be careful for two big reasons. The first one is that he's not supporting anybody. It's one thing if you want to say, it's my way or the highway, but you can't make enemies out of everybody, because sooner or later, then you're just standing alone. And I know that he hasn't lashed out at Corey Cooper. I'm sorry, was it Corey Cooper? Rory Cooper. Rory Cooper from South Africa, otherwise known as My Perspective. But let's face it, same thing would happen. What happened to you, what happened to Jaron, is if Rory goes on Patricia's show or he goes on my show, or he goes on anybody's show, he's immediately going to be labeled and that'll be it. But the bigger point here, aside from, the fact that he's being really negative, is look, and this is to him, if he's listening, he's like, man, you didn't invent flat earth. No one invented flat earth. Flat earth is 500 years old, at least. No, Matt was in the same boat for a while there. Learn from other people. Matt was lashing out, and now what's Matt doing? Is Matt making new videos? What's he up to? If you lash out at everybody and you're not the originator, again, Eric's videos, literally, you look at the timeline. His videos were only 2 months older than mine.
Mm-hmm.
Matt was talking about this stuff 3 years ago, I think, even more than that. And, when nobody was talking about it, you want to talk about a guy who was an island, it was that guy. So, just be part of the community. It's a happy group. Everyone supports each other. It's a positive thing. I tried to say this on the show last night, which was, look, man, how many movements do you know where there's multiple theme songs? I'm actually collecting, like trading cards, collecting Flat Earth theme songs right now.
Wow.
There's on my playlist right now, and it hasn't even, I haven't even created it that long ago. It's like 19 songs at least. How right. many? How, what, you see a lot of Occupy Wall Street songs, 9/11 songs? No, not with upbeat tempos and fun little, you know, humorous things. Mm-hmm. I totally dig it. So yeah,
you know what though? It's like every other freaking group I've ever seen, like veganism. You know, it's like, oh, have you, you know, are you drinking this, this, and this? Like, no, I'm new to this. And, you know, they start, it's like that cliquishness or whatever.
Yeah.
Or, you know, like into yoga, it's like, oh, you know, and then they proceed to do a firefly pose in front of you. It's like some advanced pose. And it's like, okay, show off. Like, you know, I'm new here. So it's like you go into this group too. Like I said, the same thing. And it was just like, there's always those same people. It's like the second in charge, you know, it's like the gimp. And then a crazy lady that drinks too much coffee and smokes cigarettes. She's in the corner. Yeah. Heckling on. It's like I just want to like drop a car on Eric and just be like, I'll be like, all right, I'm gonna say some names. I'll be like, Bubba Zanetti. Yeah.
Yeah.
Johnny the Boy. Uh-huh. Are there more? What's the movie reference?
I don't know.
Mad Max.
Oh, the original 1979.
And remember when he lowered the car on him?
Right. Right. I didn't memorize that one because it wasn't one of my favorites.
I got
because it was but I understood where it was going. I mean, it was way ahead of its time, and honestly, for 1979, an Australian film,
right?
Brilliant.
But you know what? I know he's going to hear this, and it's like, Eric, listen, message from me to you, lighten the F up. Guess what? The world is flat. So guess what? It's smaller than before. There's no going into space. So just stop acting like a little kid.
And there's a lot of people in this thing. I mean, there's so much material out there. So many people. It's like, look, just be part of it. Don't. Everyone wants to be the top of the heap, and everyone wants opportunities to do different things. Just play it like you were playing it, and everything would be fine. Take down it. You know, I don't want to dwell on this too much, but take down the video. You know the one I'm talking about, where he goes after an ethnic group. Don't. It's not part of what's happening here. If you want to do that on your own time. Do that on another channel. Don't. This is supposed to be a positive thing, a message of hope, message of harmony. Don't turn it into. You know, it's again. It reminds me of that Austin Powers thing where. Michael Caine has that great line. He goes, I hate people that judge what other groups and the Dutch, you know,
right.
Where you can't have it both ways. You can't say, by the way, I'm supporting this wonderful, you know, revelation that's going to wake up all of humanity and turn it potentially into the next golden age. Oh yeah, by the way, kill all these people from this specific ethnic group. But
you know what, too, and that's his prerogative, and I agree with you. If it's just for the flat Earth and people are going to get interested in this, it's not something you want to put out there for everybody. It's not for everybody, right? Whether it's true or not, whether he believes it or not, I don't really care. Listen, I already know all the same material he knows, right? It's not revolutionary. Between David Icke and Tex Mars and Jeff Rentz and all the people before him and before Alex Jones, it was Bill Cooper, and everybody in between. So it's not like it's like really heady, important stuff, all right? Even the clip he put up was like a four-hour, the greatest story never told. I saw it. Big deal. I watched it in fast forward, and I got it. I mean, and then what?
Yeah.
What? How does that pertain to the flat Earth? Anybody who's going to come? Again, it's like, you're right. It's irrelevant.
Yeah.
You want to do it on your personal page. This is what I believe in, but this is a different topic.
It's so much smaller than the whole flat Earth enclosed world thing. Every other conspiracy fits inside it. So, you know, that's why I try to focus. I go, look, every other conspiracy, I don't care what it is, becomes second tier and third tier. The only one I really focus on. And you know me, I used to be into every conspiracy. And now it's like, yeah, fine. You want to tell me new things about 9/11 or Boston bombing or Sandy Hook or JFK or Pearl Harbor? Just take your pick. It doesn't really make any difference because until the flat Earth thing is resolved one way or the other, you know, I'm going for the brass ring on this.
Right.
I really want to see this thing get resolved.
Let me say that, and I don't want to sound like I'm angry or jaded, but like I've just been at this for too friggin' long, okay?
Yeah.
I'm the type of guy that if somebody posts, I'll use GLP as a good example because I check there from time to time.
Sure.
Somebody will post a story and they'll say, and some other person who's there 24/7 will be like, oh, that's old news. Really? Because you don't have a life and you spend all your time in here clicking refresh, it's old news. Like, I've been busy all week. I've been away on vacation or, you know, I'm working for a living. And I only got in here on Friday, 5 days later. So it's not old news to me. You see what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So when people bring up these young kids, they think, I don't know, they think they're geniuses somehow. You ever hear of chemtrails? Yeah, actually, I was writing about chemtrails and talking to Clifford Carnicom before it was mainstream. What's your point? Like, I don't effing care. I know everything. I know every goddamn.
I know it all.
I'm not a know-it-all. I'm saying I know it all because I listen for 6 to 8 hours a day on average, right, to all the radio programs or more. I read the same. I always had jobs where I sat in data centers and emergency capacity where I could play on the internet all freaking day.
Yeah.
So I had all the time. I read all the David Icke books. I read Behold the Pale Horse. I mean, you name it, I read it. Okay, I'm familiar with all of it, but I just don't give a crap because at this point we are so far gone. It's 2015. The economy is screwed. I'm telling you, Mark, like this information, this flat earth conundrum, whatever you want to call it, is pivotal and important for so many things. The wasted budget from NASA to the military industrial complex to everything else. I mean, people just have to wake the F up and get inspired about something. If it's not the flat earth, then it's something else. But right now, I'm putting my money on flat earth.
Yeah, there you go.
I'm sorry.
Well,
well put.
And I'm putting everything I got on it too, because I think it's the winning ticket in this case. Until somebody has something better, something bigger.
Let me add one caveat. Because I reached out to our friend, Lord Stephen Christ. I have to say that with a chuckle because I know how you feel. But I got to be honest with you. I really sincerely meant it, and I said it on one of his videos today.
Yeah.
I invited him onto my own program because in fairness and what I preach, like I always say, perception's truth, you know, truth or error. Like everybody has a different perception.
Yeah.
And if I don't understand exactly where he's coming from, there was one video I watched his that had some kind of reticular something or other on the beach.
Oh, the reticulinator. Yeah.
Right.
Experiment. Yeah.
Right. And he spent – whoever designed that video, I don't know if it was him or somebody else, whoever did it spent a lot of time into it. I want to understand it better because – and I think that what I said to him was, listen, either you're 100% right because really it's going to be flat, right? It's going to be the earth as we know it now, or it's going to be concave.
Yeah.
I said, but even if you're only 10% right, okay, that element of truth, that part that's 10% absolute truth is 100% truth in and of itself. I want to know it because it might lend to the greater picture of all things, of this whole illusion, this whole deception. You know what I'm saying? He might have a part of it. We flat earth movement might have a part of it. NASA might have a part of it, but they can't reveal it. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
I don't think anybody's going to get the complete picture in one paradigm or one, I don't know, design.
Yep.
It's too complex because I think that's part of the rub too. When they say, well, how many people can keep this conspiracy up or how many people can be fooled? I think it's because it's really intricate and complex.
Yeah.
Again, I'm done with my rant. I've got it out of my system. Let's start your show.
Wow. Welcome to Strange World. Wow. Thank you. No. I love it when you speak up because I know how passionate you are. And most of the time you hold back. But I know that Eric got you up. And the Stephen thing, oh, man. Yeah, Stephen, if you're listening, please do Jonathan's show or try to do Patricia's show. Do somebody's show. Yeah. Come on. We're not picking on you because we hate you.
And I got to say one last thing, again, to Eric. If you notice, I've never made my own friggin' video. I've never put out information. I've never put myself as a proponent of the flat earth movement.
Yeah.
Maybe that's why, like you said, why don't you take bullets? Because I'm literally just a wingman and I have my own show, my own topics I'm trying to develop.
Yeah.
But like, I'm not, you know what I'm saying? Like, I'm not trying to take other people's material. I'm not trying to analyze it. I'm not trying to be an authoritative figure on it.
Yeah.
And I said, and I think you've been the best, like I said, businessman or salesman on the pitch.
Yeah.
In making it palatable for the common person to look at it objectively.
Yeah.
Because if they go into his forum and ask the wrong question, they're going to get banned anyway. So where are they? Back to square zero and mainstream media, Fox News?
Good point. And you could make videos. I know you're way more talented at this. I mean, you know your Photoshop. You're way better at audio stuff than I am. Probably better at video too.
I'm burnt out. I just don't care. I'm seeing a lot of creativity out there by so many other people.
Yeah,
and again, it would be redundant. I mean, I think everybody's getting it, and I think that organic growing it that way organically is so much more important because I think it's going to inspire one another to keep on going with it.
I agree.
Yeah.
And with that, let's do this because we still got some time before the break. I'd like to open up because we are reading a statement from a U.S. Army field artillery operator. And he wrote in anonymously, and feel free to chime in as I'm reading this thing. But I've got his PDF in front of me. It's not very long, so I think we can definitely get in for the break. Whether or not we comment on it before the break is a whole other thing. But he wanted to be completely anonymous, and he wrote this 3 days ago for me. So it's by anonymous. And he goes into a little bit of back history, and I think it's fair, and I'm not going to edit any of it out. I'm going to read it as is, just so everybody knows, and hopefully he's listening, and I know he is. This statement is written with the intention to help people wake up to the truth that we do not live on a spinning globe circling a gigantic distant sun. I will tell you about me. At the age of 32, the year 2005, I accepted Yeshua the Christ in my heart and was transformed to a new person with a fresh new way of thinking. Immediately, inspired by the Holy Spirit, I began to understand the scriptures, which revealed a different universe, as we have been taught. After reading at that time, I knew the moon missions were faked, and still it never crossed my mind the truth of the flat earth or plateau. That was the little thing you put in there. I decided to proof the universe. I knew through the words of the Bible and always found myself questioning the endless space. I understood that the God of the Bible did not intend for humans to reach the stars, more or less the firmament. The story of the Tower of Babel is clear enough proof that God will not allow humans to reach across the barrier dome. Moreover, the simple statement of "look up and praise the Lord" may be questioned, the globe having skies all around. By default, I can be looking down and still look towards God's throne or his domain. Still to this moment, the flat earth never crossed my mind. Fast forwarding here to the year of 2010, the age of 37, when I joined the United States Army. Got in pretty late. My job in the electronic maintenance section is to fix and maintain the field artillery radars operational. I had 1 year of training from the history of radio waves to the radar technology of today, and through all the training, sometimes in the back of my mind was telling me something is missing here for these radars to work appropriately. This is the equipment capable of generating up to 120 kilowatts to amplify the 2.4 gigahertz frequency in order to shoot the pencil beams downrange to a maximum distance of 50 kilometers or 30 miles. By the way, the 2.4 gigahertz frequency spectrum involves the Wi-Fi and satellites communications. You can search the communication sheet on Wikipedia by typing the electromagnetic spectrum. And he sent me one of those, and it's really, really cool. I encourage anybody to look at it. It's a little hard to read because it's so jam-packed with stuff. But anyway, so I get deployed to Afghanistan, and the first day on the job, I find the operators discussing whether or not the radar could actually track anything according to the position of the geography of the area. In the middle of their conversation, I suddenly came to this absurd idea and spoke, "Well, I think the beams should follow the Earth's curvature in order to work at such distances, right?" The look they gave me was enough for me to stay out of the conversation. Then, after thinking of the statement, I asked myself, how in the world are we actually tracking anything if the beams shoot straight, then eventually they would shoot out into space, and still no idea of the flat Earth. It wasn't until this year, 2015, that my wife started showing me the images, thank you, by the way, to Mr. Anonymous's wife, from what I think are from Rob Skiba's website. I ignored her. What, not my website? What, I'm not good enough? That's fine. That's totally fine. I ignored her for a while because I was too busy with work and the present. Also, I kind of been upset with humanity because they just won't believe there's a God or an intelligent creator. One day around the beginning of summer, while sitting in the motor pool at the radar, I decided to hear one of Rob's radio broadcasts. Wow, my brain just clicked literally. I felt it going down my spine and boom, another layer dropped from the scales on my eyes. Ooh, neat. The fact that Rob used the Bible and the Book of Enoch, which I began reading years back, but stopped because it did not match our reality of the globe. Since then, I can't stop the research, and wow, now I can look up and say, yes, my God. Back to the radar. So the pencil beams start in comparison with the point of a pencil, and it widens to a cylindrical shape, which we already knew because Jaron ran into that accidentally when he was shooting that beam across the water. Anyways, the rockets or any projectile needs to break the plane that these beams create at the lowest level of the mountain peaks, which brings us to the curvature equation and the discrepancy of elevation. The beams have to travel on a flat trajectory track. Anything at 30 miles out and the curvature is a 600-foot drop, there can be no accuracy. Like the other military men have stated on Mark Sargent's radio broadcast, no curvature is ever taken into consideration with any weapon. I would like to include images here, but you can search them online at Wikipedia. There is information on this radar. It is the AN-T PQ-37 radar system and the spectrum frequency chart. Signed, anonymous. So thank you. Thank you very much. And we've got a couple minutes before break to discuss it. But yeah, so he's basically, he's a field artillery operator, you know, on the radar side, on the technical side, and he's saying straight up, they also have to use, they just don't shoot howitzers into space. They beam them out, just like Sean McCrae's systems always beam them out. You know, paint the target if all possible. And painting the target is a lot cheaper than it used to be, and a lot, you know, a lot more powerful, a lot more efficient. And he's saying you can't do it. Not if it's a curve, you can't do it. It won't work. So there you have it. Trying to paint the targets with a pencil beam radar at, you know, 30 miles should not be able to do it, you know, with on certain targets. Yeah, it's a lot easier on the water because we always know the water's flat. But you're, you know, if you're in the desert, like he was in Afghanistan, I'm sure there's some flat parts of Afghanistan. So anyway, there you have it. I thought it was pretty cool. So thank you very much for writing that in. Anyone else wants to write? We should probably give out the phone number before we go to break, right?
Yeah.
Toll-free number to call in. That's True Frequency Radio. Real people, real radio is 866-37-TRUTH or 866-378-7884. And when we come back from the break, we're going to go through mailbag and see what other fun stuff people can write and talk to us about. And there's actually some good stuff already. And yeah, anyone wants to give us more information, you know, we've got Army, we've got Navy, we've got a flight instructor. I'd love to get Air Force before it's over. Marines got that Marine sniper instructor. I mean, I don't have an official one, but anyway, we'll deal with more of this when we get back from the break.
Right now.
Yeah.
Hello, my old friend. How are you up today?
Frank, it's time for a date. Yes, much. Are you ready?
Hey, my last move yesterday was a three from E6 to
Strange World with Mark Sargent. Saturdays on Truth Frequency Radio.
Welcome to Strange World. I'm your host, Mark, with my co-host, Jonathan from Jersey. And we're talking about, well, we're trying to talk about flat earth friendship. And so far, it hasn't been going real well.
Friendship? Did you say friendship?
not when Jonathan's El Fuego. And he's lighting up the airwaves with his rants. No, I love it when you do rants, and I wish you'd do more, honestly.
Really?
Yeah, I know, but your superiors have said that as a handler, you're supposed to kind of ride shotgun.
I'm not supposed to lose it like that.
Yeah. No, you didn't lose it. I thought you were fine.
All right.
And no, it's fine. Oh, by the way, you and I were kind of chatting off air, and you were showing that email from that one guy, you know, because every once in a while, and he wasn't the first, you know, people said, well, you know, the Navy guy and the sub guy and the sniper guy you mentioned, it's like, that's a bunch of crap. You know, there's all sorts of manuals that show that there's the Coriolis effect, the spin of the earth is used in the firing solutions for all these things. And that's fine and dandy. Fine.
It's just the way, I must be in angry mode all night tonight. I swear to God. It's the way they ask the question. They don't even ask. They demand an answer. It's like the fat guy at the deli who doesn't take a frigging ticket. He just steps up and be like, yeah, like a half a pound of pastrami, a pound of gabagool. Really? Like, I'm not effing standing here? Now you're hearing New Jersey come out.
Wow, that is Jersey. That's really good. Sorry. No, it's okay. But look, you know, you want to dispute the sniper stuff? Fine. Show me the manuals. Show me the calculations. Show me what they're using. And then find me a sniper that'll come out and say, oh, yeah, absolutely, you're using that. Yeah, because right now I'm lining people up. Look at all the people. We just did an artillery guy. just now. And he wasn't even the first artillery guy. He was the second one. The first one just kind of wrote in a short little blurb, and he was stationed in Fallujah. And where is Fallujah? Is that Iran? Somebody should look that up. Anyway, he was a station in Fallujah, and he said, no, it's not in the firing solution. And then this guy comes in, and he goes, yeah, I was in Afghanistan. He's anonymous because he's still in. You know, he's supporting his family, and he says, look, I'm doing the radar on the field artillery. We're firing a pencil beam at 30 miles. We're not using curvature. He didn't go into the Coriolis effect, but I bet you eventually he will. I'm waiting for his follow-up on that. So anyway.
I think at this point you should write a book and call it The World According to Mark.
No. Don't give me that much credit.
They ask for answers as if like it's like in a book, like an appendix. Like yeah. We're all trying to figure this out.
Yeah, I know. And
they want definitive proof.
And I don't get insulted when people email me, and literally, I'm not kidding you, when they email me and say, hey, do you happen to have a picture of the flat? They're not kidding. They're not, you know, they're not being sarcastic or anything. Say, hey, do you happen to have a picture of the flat earth you can send me? I'd like to see it. And they're not messing around. It's like, no, that picture does. If I had that picture, do you think I'd be doing a radio show right now? No, I'd be deep underground trying to get this thing out. Nobody would know my name. I wouldn't be telling anybody.
But you know what it is? It's like, when they ask sincerely, you can't but want to help.
I do want to help, right? but I know that it's in their head. That's the great thing about this movement is there's so much information now that if people ask me about different topics, no, I don't get back to every email. But a lot of it's deliberate because of the email, I can see where they're going. It's like they just haven't gotten that far yet.
Right.
So if they want to talk about the sun and the moon and meteors and the aurora borealis and tectonics and anything they want, because they'll always open the letter with, I just started looking at this, and it's like, fine, well, you're going to take another 3 or 4 days. And generally they'll either write back or they'll figure it out themselves. No, part of it's, helping people help themselves. Help me help you.
You know what it reminds me of real quick?
What?
When I was in France, I needed an iron. I had to iron a shirt for a business meeting.
Yeah.
And so the note comes with the iron and it says, Monsieur Macedo, here's the iron you demanded.
Yeah.
But the word demander, it means to ask in French. It doesn't mean demand like we mean it here, like I demand an answer. So I went downstairs and I'm like, I didn't demand anything. I was just asking politely for an iron.
Nice.
Nice. Anyway.
Well, let's get through this while we're waiting for calls to come in. Let's go through a couple things from the mailbag because I always have, interesting people. I saved the emails for the show that I think are great little tidbits of information. Most of them are pretty short. By the way, if you do want to call in, number is 866-37-TRUTH. Or if you just don't want to stare at the letters and figure it out, it's 866-378-7884. But from the mailbag, which was, again, left open on my secretary's desk, lazy secretary, this one's from Rick, and he says, many thanks. Just to let you know, in my former life, I was a forensic scientist before the UK government privatized it all off. For some of it, I worked in firearms. During velocity testing, we would have to account for the gravity constant. Whenever this was spoken about between the more experienced reporting officers, it was always approached with a nervous giggle of bemusement because they knew the pull of gravity, if it exists, varied all over the globe plane, which cannot be suitably explained or even accepted by science. Anyway, I think the Flat Earth community are all aware of Operation Paperclip, but you need to go further back and get the juice on Jack Parsons. Something is smelly. Cheers, Rick from England. So thank you very much, Rick.
Very cool.
Yeah. So gravity, shooting. Great. Wonderful.
And by the way, I think you have a call.
We'll bring him in, man.
All right. Caller, you're on the air.
Hey, how's it going, guys?
Wait, I know this voice.
Yeah, who is this? Wait a minute.
It's your favorite Navy missile instructor.
Hey, it's Sean McCrary.
What's up?
Soon to be headed for Section 8.
Hey.
He keeps going the way he's going.
So how y'all doing?
Good. What are you staying up late for? What's going on?
Well, it's Veterans Day tomorrow, and I have tomorrow off. So
nice.
Oh, right on.
Good for you.
Anybody hooking you up? Free meals, free gas, free car wash, free?
There's a few places around.
So yeah. you're not gonna drive around town and start hitting people up.
I might go to Olive Garden. They're having a treat now.
Bro, you make it to New Jersey, I'll take you out for real Italian.
There you go.
I'll take you around.
Nice. So did you have any? Were you calling on the comments? The field artillery operator.
I was actually calling in on the some of the naysayers. I was kind of here to back up what you said. All these supposed manuals that people are saying exist that, you know, incorporate the Coriolis effect. Please show me them, because I've dealt with, you know, hundreds and hundreds of manuals. So I don't know what they're talking about.
Right on. So that makes perfect sense. I figured if there were, you would have mentioned something along those lines anyway. And from what you were talking about, you were saying that every once in a while it might be just glossed over, but it's never actually used in practice.
Exactly.
Can I say something to that?
Yeah.
My dad knew a guy who was friends with a guy who said that he had manuals, but his cousin had them. So.
Which is why, by the way, I did that Ferris Bueller intro where the girl in the classroom was describing where Ferris was. You know, my friend's best friend's former roommate's little brother saw Ferris pass out at 31 Flavors last night. You know, it's the epitome of all grapevines, and I love it. Yeah, whatever. Or that guy that said that he called me from Oregon and I told him on the phone that I was working for the NSA. And that was how, you know, it's like, really? That's credible? That's how you're going to play with it? Because I just tell somebody that.
And you know what? And just, by the way, real quick, we got a ton of calls coming in now. So either I pissed somebody off or they're finally catching on to call.
Oh, crap. So we had calls coming in. Sean, I hate to do this to you, but we're going to have to go something else unless you do. But thank you. Thank you very much.
You're good, man.
Your opinion is always.
You guys are great. Keep it up.
Well received. Thanks, man. Hope we talk
I'll
to you soon.
I'll give you a shout tomorrow, too, man.
All right, take it easy, guys.
All right.
Okay. We do have more calls coming in?
Yeah.
Oh, great. So, all right. Let's do it, and then I'll read a cool little letter before the break. So who's next?
Coming out of Nebraska.
Ooh, all right.
Think you're on the air?
Hello.
Hey, Nebraska, what's going on?
Not a whole lot. How's it going?
Good, good. What's on your mind tonight?
Oh, I got a little saying for Mark.
Okay.
It kind of fits him. Nobody cares how much you know until they know how much you care.
Oh, that's good.
Yeah, I like that.
Yeah. That's good. I've never heard that one, and I'm a big fan of saying as you know. That's great. Cool. Was there anything else? Because that's – seriously, care. Somebody put that on a T-shirt.
No, quickly, I was going to say, maybe this is already something that has been thought of, but is there any possibility that, or is there any type of, so there's a curvature, you know, 8 inches per mile square. Is there like a format for like angles, like, you know, let's say like you're looking 60 miles out, is there a formula that should say, like, you know, a building or something should be tilted so many or so much degrees?
Oh, good one.
Degree formula?
No, you're right. And that's an excellent point. Up until now, I think everybody's just been saying, well, they should be tilted. But I don't think anyone's actually done the math formula to show what the tilt would be.
Because if the math is done and people can figure out the formula for an actual degree on like, you know, how, like, the actual degree on what a building should be tilted. Yeah. I was just, you know, thinking of a couple examples. Like, let's say you're, you know, holding a slice of pizza up in front of your face.
Yeah.
You know, it's going to look flat, you know, kind of like Gumby standing sideways.
Yeah.
But then, you know, you tilt that pizza forward or vice versa, backwards, whatever, it's going to look like a triangle.
Excellent
point.
So
would there be some type of experiment where, you know, something within a distance, let's say you have a triangle and on the two ends, maybe you had one colored light and on the top point, you had a different colored light. And then, you know, if they're all in a line, if there's a degree to it, you know, would they not be in a straight line? Or another example of something you could do would be, at a certain degree, maybe a reflector or something is not revealed until a certain degree, where, you know, a light could only hit that reflector if it hit a certain degree or something. I don't know if there's any way to add a test to, you know, calculating that degree into play.
Yeah. Excellent point. And, but yeah, anyone listening out there, whoever's working on stuff, you're right, because everybody's been estimating until this point. Even Rory Cooper, you know, he just tilts the things backwards. But I don't think he even, you know, measured it by degrees.
Well,
so,
well, whatever it is, I mean, you'd have to start 90 degrees would be your parallel to the horizon.
Yeah.
And then you'd have to multiply it exponentially by the same curve rate. You know, it would have to increase square by the mile. It wouldn't just be a slope.
No.
Right? It would incrementally fall off.
You're right. It would,
off.
It would also increase, the same way a curve does. So it'd be something degree, whatever it is, squared. So, yeah.
But he's asking what the angle of declination would be with each increment.
Something that somebody should look into soon. I'll try to dig into it tomorrow. But anyone listening, please, that's a great one to put out there, because we are, literally up until now, it's all been estimation. So let's go. All right.
Yeah, just, I thought it'd be a starting point, something to branch off of. But
thank you. Thank you very much.
I'll let you guys get on to some different callers.
Okay. Thanks, Nebraska. Talk to you soon.
All right. Later.
Bye bye.
Wait, did I say declination? Or did I mean depression, angle depression?
Dude, you're not going to figure this out now, are you?
No, I'm going to do it. He's got me thinking, though. I'm going to look at this later on.
Well, tell you what. Do we have another caller? Can I read a letter?
Let me see. Are they dropped off?
Okay, perfect.
Okay.
I want to read a letter real quick, because I actually should have read this last week. Because remember a while ago when my good friend Miss Steer, otherwise known as Patricia Steer, she was having problems, and so I went on air. That was actually when we were waiting for you to wake up from a food coma. And I asked people to send her some, you know, cheer her up and send her some nice emails. And there was one that was forwarded to me, and I just wanted to read it real quick. Because, again, this is the power of the movement, and it's a really positive thing. How many movements do you know where if somebody's getting upset with the movement, you can just say, hey, by the way, cheer this person, you know, they need a little feel good, a little pat on the back, and all of a sudden, boom, you know, letter. And that's what happens. So I wanted to read this one real quick. So real quick, this is from a woman named Jen, and she wrote to Patricia. She said, I have just started listening to this week's Strange World, and Mark mentioned you were having a hard time. I typically don't reach out like this, but you need to know that you have support out there, and that your show, as small as you may think it is so very important to people that are waking up to the reality, or at least the questions, of our world. I have watched and listened to literally hundreds of hours of Flat Earth material on YouTube. I have looked at material supporting Flat Earth, or at least questioning the globe. And at debunkers, they have literally got nothing. Mark Sargent opened my eyes. Rob Skiba put it in context. Eric Dubay showed me real evidence. See, part of a team, Eric, you don't even know it. And you have been like a big sister holding my hand and grounding me as I slowly, actually very quickly, you put a lot of things in parentheses, Jen, start to think I am going crazy. Your show offers something special and unique that would be an immense loss to the movement. We need a better word for that. I watch your shows and see a sweet, kind, and genuine person who is very courageously putting herself out there right in the firing line in order to share truth. I applaud you, Patricia. I'm in the UK, in Southampton. Thank you, in the UK. I don't know a single other person that is physically in my life that is on the same page as me or even on the same bookshelf. I can relate to you, and I'm sure others can too. How you have explained your journey mirrors my own experience. Flat Earth very quickly rang true for me. It made almost immediate sense and made everything else make sense too. It was like being given a code to decrypt an illegible book. On YouTube, you could easily be mistaken in thinking lots of people were on the same page, but in reality, the number is very small but happily growing. What's more, we are all spread out across the world. Connecting with like-minded people in person is not yet a reality. Your show allows this connection virtually. People are waking up benefit from seeing, hearing, and connecting with others that are also waking up. Of course, the establishment wants to stop and will consequently troll you relentlessly. They want us all sound asleep, watching TV and going to sports games, Is that what other people do? I can't remember. They don't want us talking to each other. They don't want our minds or eyes opening. They don't want us seeing the truth. And they certainly don't want people taking the message public. You don't deserve to be hounded. And I really don't understand why anyone would harass you. You haven't said or done anything offensive, and you haven't hurt or abused anyone. I hope you're okay. Stay strong. All the very best to you, Jen.
Wow.
Yeah. I know. Exactly. And how many things can you say this about? That's what this whole thing is, what my show does and other people's work does. It's like, look, it's a positive thing, and that's why I try to keep it positive. Yes, I know I include cartoons every once in a while and funny quotes and different things. Like at the end of this one, I've got another Schoolhouse Rock thing, Conjunction Junction, which I happen to love, and it also teaches things.
And if Patricia's listening, like we don't talk, like you and her talk all the time. Yeah. But you're more than welcome to walk point in my army at any time.
Nice.
Yeah, she wants to be a target.
Oh, I see what you did. That was good. That was good. Because I was going, wait, Vietnam. Wait, you don't walk point. You're the first one to get shot at.
Oops, I'm sorry.
But if you're good, you make it.
Yeah, there you go. So that's what I meant.
So there you go. Anyway, let's look real quick here at the next one. This one's from Kathy. And it says, Mr. Sargent, did you ever hear about the miracle of the sun witnessed by 70,000 people 98 years ago? And she gives me a link to the miracle of the sun. I think
that's
you'll find
cool.
It.
Yeah.
Very, yeah, yeah. And I had completely forgotten about the miracle of the sun, where the sun appeared to do a lot of really strange things, like it was instanced in the programming sense, the realization of an object, where it was doing some funky dance in the sky with like a weird light show. And all these people were standing in the crowd watching it. How could all these people notice this thing, but the rest of the world didn't witness that same sun? You know, and it was very, very interesting. Again, it goes into the whole aspect of the projection system maybe able to react demographically or regionally. We don't know. So that was neat. So anyone wants to look it up, Miracle of the Sun. Very, very cool. So while we're waiting for calls, I'm sorry, did you have something?
No. It just got me thinking because I'd always considered that to be a spiritual phenomena, you know, or like mass hallucination or something like that,
yeah.
or you know, divine interventions. You know, something was going on spiritual.
Oh, you mean with the sun miracle?
Yeah, because there was enough people of faith, and it's that whole, you know, mind over matter.
Oh,
you know,
they manifested it.
Yeah, they were all expecting something in mass, but they didn't know what. And then when it started happening, it's just like everybody joined into the phenomena. It's like look at the recent missile thing in California.
Oh, Los Angeles, yeah.
And then now those that went with the whole UFO idea, again, I'm not saying what it was, but it picked up momentum. And then all of a sudden, you know, it builds energy and people are like, oh my God, it's UFO. And
yeah. And then, of course, you know, the military comes out and says, no, we were testing something. And it's like, man, there's only so many times you can do that after the fact.
Right.
You know, because they want to shut people up because that's like, you know, that's what everybody goes for. They immediately will bite on that. It's an easy piece of bait to throw out. Yep. Like sorry, go ahead.
No, I was going to say, do we have time for one more call before break?
6 minutes. Yeah, we can do it. Why, you got one?
Yeah, real quick. Let's see. Caller, you're on the air.
Hello.
Where are you calling from?
Hello. I'm in New York.
New York, fantastic.
Right on.
What's on your mind?
How you doing? My name is Mark also.
Right on, even better.
I wanted to call in and say thank you. I mean, you guys put on a good show. I listen a lot, and I'm very, very interested in this subject. And I wouldn't say I'm 100% convinced, but it's very overwhelming. I mean, the facts that you're putting out there are just amazing.
Well, thank you.
And I had a question about the human eye and the field of vision.
Sure.
How wide is the field of vision? Because I got to say, you ruined my vacation. Just before we went on vacation, I stumbled onto your clues, and I was kind of obsessed with it. We were at the beach. We were in North Carolina, and the whole time I was at the shore, I kept looking out and wondering, why can't I see a curve of the horizon? If I'm seeing more than what they say is the distance at the curve.
Yeah.
I forgot what it's called.
But, oh.
I mean, why wouldn't I see
past the vanishing point?
The horizon is flat. Yeah.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, it was just bothering me. I don't know what that width is.
It's
trying to think of it. Oh, I'm sorry. Go ahead.
Well, it's 114 degrees horizontally for our visual. And then the remaining peripheral is like 60 to 70 degrees. But if you're looking at it from terms of a camera, it's about an f2.1 lens, if that means anything. So you can always adjust your focus, too, based on what you look at. And when somebody holds their hand right in front of you and you say, look at my hand. And then if they look at the hand, the face should be blurry or anything behind it is blurry. And they say, now look at my face. And then the hand is blurry. So, of course, we have that ability to shift. But if you're talking about lateral side to side, it's about 114 degrees.
Okay.
Is that what you were asking?
Interesting. Yes.
And if,
yes.
And if you didn't get that, go ahead.
No, go ahead. I'm sorry. I don't mean to step on you. I'm trying to – I've been trying to get a hold of you guys, and I have so many questions and so much stuff. I'm going to have to start emailing it.
I like when we step on each other. It's like the old CB radio days of the 70s, so it's cool.
There you go. I should start saying over Roger and stuff.
Yes. And I'll tell you, I'm a 48-year-old Hispanic male. I was in law enforcement. I currently work for an insurance company as an auto investigator, estimator. Family's all law enforcement. So I've always kind of looked at this stuff with a critical sense that, you know, something's going on. You know, there's just too many inconsistencies, and not even in just flat earth. I mean, all the subjects, especially like some of the things that you were talking about last week, Jonathan, with the, you know, with 9/11 and things like that. There's just so many inconsistencies
right. That
are out there, and they just scream at you. And once you wake up and look at this, it's hard to look at anything else, you know, with I guess the eyes that we were programmed with, you know, growing up. And two things. Also, I wanted to say, they kept talking about the weather balloon and at night. Can't we do it offshore in international waters?
Oh, I'd say just do it.
Right? I mean,
don't worry about the international waters.
Frustrated me. I wish somebody would just do it too.
Yeah. Bend the rules a bit. And yeah, absolutely.
Exactly. Also, I've noticed I went on to, I've been, you know, I always constantly Google things and just try and see what's out there, what they're saying. And one of the university websites gives the wrong information. They describe a slope, not a curvature of the earth. They tell you that, you know, 8 inches every mile. And I don't understand why these people are out there. This is a university, and they're giving the wrong information. Is it intentional?
Unless somebody's proofreading it. I know what you're saying.
They teach common.
Kind of amazing. Yeah, and then even on the Weather Channel, I saw something yesterday that three scientists walked into a bar thing, and they said that, when you see the sun go set, you're not actually seeing it, that it's already around the curvature of the earth and the light is curved. Well, where did it come up with this stuff?
Yeah, agreed. You know, hey, I'm just
fascinated.
Did you have one more point? We got 1 minute till the break. What was the other thing you want to talk about?
One more real quick thing.
Yeah.
A friend of mine works for Sylvania Osram, and he was talking about light, and he's, for some reason, he thinks that light would curve around the surface of the earth because of gravity. And I don't understand how they could come up with that. I mean, if they're showing like Jarenism did with his laser.
If it's curved. Yeah, good point, man. Thanks very much for calling in from New York. We'll be back just a bit.
Oh, absolutely. Thank you for talking to me, and I'll know you again.
Hold tight, caller. We'll get you as soon as we get back from the break.
This is Truth Frequency Radio.
The wicked ones, obviously under heavy Masonic influence.
Welcome back to Strange World. I'm your host, Mark Sargent, and with me is Jonathan from Jersey, and we're doing segment 3.
What's up?
Out of 4, yeah.
We got two callers now, just to let you know, but go ahead and say what you're going to say.
Two callers on the line. Well, let me read this real quick because it takes about 30 seconds. I want to get this one in because I'm trying to burn through some of the mailbag. It's still from the secretary's desk. This one's real quick. It says, this is from Mark, which already makes it cool, and it says, brilliant, brilliant, and brilliant. No, that's not the name of a new law firm. That is my response to you for your Flat Earth Clues series. Thank you for putting your immense amount of talent to good use. Sincerely, Mark from Lake County Pool and Spa Care. Hope he doesn't mind me reading that on air. Anyway, thanks very much. I'll take the compliment when it comes. So anyway, we have callers.
Right on.
Who we got?
Let's see who we got here. Out of Virginia, had you on before break, and you're on the air.
Hey, it's David. I'm from Richmond, Virginia.
Hey.
What's up?
I love your show. I've been listening to you guys. Are you still there?
Yeah. It's okay. We can hear you.
What are you using, GPS?
Yes. Stop using GPS. Go back to the land system.
Go back to land system. Yeah.
I listen to you guys all the time. I'm on the road like constantly.
Yeah.
Just love your intuition on this. A friend of mine's actually an architectural engineer, and he had an experiment, and he's actually very interested in this, and he says it's pretty easy, but it would be hard to actually get approval to do. But if you could find somebody to do it, then, I mean, it would be a hole-in-one, basically, for Flat Earth.
Okay.
And the experiment basically is any long bridge has to be a bridge that has two support beams that go up. We're talking about like a mile-long bridge. Like, say, for instance, the Golden Gate Bridge.
Sure.
And what he says is if you get up the top of the Golden Gate Bridge, the posts are supposed to be the support posts. They're supposed to be both the exact same height. Now, if you shine a beam from one post to the other, if the earth is curved, the beam will not hit the post.
Ooh, good one.
Now, you'd have to have a long stretch to do this.
Yeah.
But you can calculate via the curve of the earth, or the supposed curve of the earth, through this experiment. So if that beam does not hit the other post, then you have a curved earth.
Excellent.
But if it hits the other post, you have a hole in one.
Nice.
Would it work on the Verrazano Bridge? Because I can get over there in like a half hour and get some pizza.
If you can get somebody to approve it,
you might be onto something.
And get access to do it.
Yeah, that's a good one. The only problem with that, though, and I'm sure Jaron, if he's listening, is probably thinking of the same thing, and that is you're going to have some beam dispersal. So many inches per mile, or so many feet per mile, or whatever it was. So, but yeah, that's not a bad idea at all. I like it.
You know what? I'm just going to pull a Turk 182 and go do it.
Wow. Wow, you're going to pull a Timothy Hutton reference out. That's excellent.
Nice.
Tyler knew.
But thank you for taking my call, guys. I'll let you get to other calls, okay?
All right, thanks, man. Bye. Thanks. Before we take the next call, is he still there, by the way?
Somebody in Clearwater, Florida.
Okay, before we take Florida, let me read this one real quick. This letter came in from Christian, and he says, hey, Mark, we'll make this short. On a very clear day, you can see the island of, Mallorca, 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 from Barcelona. That's 220 kilometers. According to curvature math, it should be 3.5 kilometers under the horizon. Another nail in the coffin. Hope this email makes it to the show. And it did, Chris. See, dreams can come true. Keep up the great work, Chris. Sent from my iPhone.
That's awesome.
Yeah. So, yeah, the island of – people look that up. The island of Mallorca?
Mallorca, I think it's, right?
whatever, M-A-L-L-O-R-C-A from Barcelona. Fantastic. So Clearwater, Florida, right?
Yep. Let me see if we can get them on the air. 1 second. In Florida, you're on the air?
Hi, good evening.
Hey, what's going on?
Can you hear me?
Yeah. What's going on?
Hello? Okay. Hi, Mark. Hi, Jonathan.
Hey.
Yeah.
what's on your mind?
Anonymous. It's anonymous.
Lower your radio. You might be getting feedback.
No, I'm not speaking through the phone.
Okay. What do you want to talk about?
Yeah. It's by anonymous, anyways. yes. I did see the evidence town hall at Flat Earth Hoax today.
Oh yeah,
from
yeah.
Emory College.
Yep, Emory College. Yep.
And Mark was talking about it. So I went in and saw that today. It was.
It is. You're right.
I guess.
Yeah, it is up, and I did watch it, and I probably should have mentioned it last week. It's okay, but it's not really pushing the flat earth one way or the other. It's just kind of like a thought process on how to find evidence. And so one guy wasn't pushing flat earth. He was just giving, his how people came to certain conclusions argument. And
exactly. Yeah,
it was okay.
It was horrible.
For what it was, I mean, I kind of had a feeling that's where it was going anyway, but, hey, look, it's. You know, the more we get out there, eventually we're going to have a serious debate before it's over, and I can't wait to see it.
I'll do that. Hey, thank you for reading my statement tonight. It sounded better, right?
Oh, right.
Than me reading it.
Cool. No. I'm sorry. Yeah. No. I was happy to read it, and I'm glad you wrote in, man. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
All right, guys. Thank you. Thank you for taking my call.
You have a good night, okay?
All right.
All right. Have a good one.
By the way,
yeah.
On that last question about the buildings leaning away, mm-hmm. The spherical depression, the formula is impossible. Under the accepted statute of spherical trig, mm-hmm. It would be impossible to even see an object to confirm angular tilt for something beneath the horizon. Because with the tilt, so comes vertical shrinking from the viewer's perspective.
Yeah.
Therefore, putting it further below the horizon. And that's from our good buddy, Sean McCrary.
Nice. Gotta love Sean. He's going to become famous one day. I almost guarantee it.
Yeah.
Hopefully in a good way. not to be the first military officer thrown out on a Section 8 for liking Flat Earth. And then there's this huge lawsuit and he wins. That's why I hope it doesn't happen. Oh, by the way, I just got a message from somebody that said the island is pronounced Mallorca.
Mallorca, that's it, yeah.
Mallorca. Mallorca or Mallorca? No, Mallorca. So thank you, Research Department for Strange World, and you know who you are. So do we have another call or do we have another mail for me?
No, we're clear for a bit.
Perfect. This one's a little bit longer. By the way, if you guys want to call in and talk to Mark and Jonathan live, please call 1-866-37-TRUTH or 866-378-7884. Operators are standing by. And by that, I mean Jonathan, unless he's trying to choke down some Chinese food.
I'm not eating anything right now. I'm good.
No, you're not. But it's good. Well, it's late where you are. It's past midnight. Or it's 1 in the morning where you are.
Yeah, it's 1:10. It's 2.
Okay. So this email is from – who's it from? From Anthony. Anthony writes, Mark, there is no mention in the media about refueling the ISS. To keep the ISS oriented so the solar panels pointed to the sun requires rocket fuel. In normal use, with the movements inside and outside forces, the ISS is going to start to tumble. It cannot be avoided. There must be small rocket motors constantly firing to keep the ISS oriented correctly. They must be controlled by the three-axis gyroscopes. There must be two on the space shuttle, like a naval ship. How long does a gyroscope last in service without maintenance? How much fuel would be needed to balance the ISS for a month, for a year? How much fuel could a cargo capsule carry to fuel the ISS? It would take a spacewalk to connect hoses for the fuel transfer, or one must consider valves and seals. I have read and watched some information about rockets in space. I am coming to the conclusion that they cannot work in a vacuum. A rocket cannot push against nothing. The theory of a rocket pushing against itself is like picking yourself up by your own bootstraps. Oh, interesting. I hadn't heard that one. You must include the fuel as a component of the mass of the rocket. To move something in a vacuum, there must be some reaction separated from the rocket. There must be an explosion a short distance away to create a reaction for the rocket. The original Orion concept was to have small nuclear explosions under a capsule. Spraying and burning propellant just does not work. When you see a rocket launch, you see the thrust billow out to the side. As it gets higher, there is less atmosphere to push against. Soon the rocket pushes against, wait for it, nothing. For an action, there must be a reaction in space. There is no possibility of a reaction in space. No one can hear you scream. I added that. He didn't. Evidence must always trump belief. The evidence is pointing to a flat Earth. It looks like we are lab rats in some kind of experiment for some higher entity. Anthony from Northern Idaho. If read on air, just use the first name. Oh, okay. Probably should have put that at the beginning. Anthony, thank you. Wait until the end of the email. By the way, don't read my name. It's a good dork. But thank you, Anthony.
All right. You have another call.
Oh, great. Now you know that we're not scripting any of this stuff.
No.
Who's this call from?
This is from Texas. Says anonymous, could be the hacker.
Good afternoon, Mark and Jonathan. How are you?
Good. Hey, boy, that is not a Texas accent. Where is that from?
I'm actually calling from Australia. I called your show last week.
Oh, cool.
Oh, right on.
Yeah, you must be routing through some Texas thing. What can we do for you?
Yeah, I am actually. I called Jonathan yesterday too, and he's coming through Houston somehow. I'm not sure what's going on there.
Weird.
How are you guys? Good?
I'm pretty good.
I can't complain. I mean, I could, but I'm not going to.
Now, wait a minute. Is it 5:30 over in your? It's 5:15 over there.
Yeah, 5:15 p.m.
See, I was paying attention last time
on Wednesday. Yeah, that's right, because he's in the future, as Jonathan.
That's right.
He's actually in
the future. You're a guarantee that tomorrow will come.
Well, okay. See, that's the funny thing about all these apocalypse, right? How are we supposed to blow up first, and then 15 hours later, you guys blow up? I don't know how it works.
Well, you know, in the latest movies that have been put out there recently, Australia's the last one to get it. You know, they're the last one. So the blast wave always hits you guys last, from what I understand.
How can that always happen? It always hits the East Coast first.
Yeah. Yeah. I don't know. Anyway, so what do you got? What's on your mind?
So I just wanted to talk about the flat Earth current map that's sort of been circulating around, the azimuthal equidistant map.
Yep.
I believe that needs a bit of work done. I don't think it's right in its ratios, and I'll use Australia as an example. On that map, if you can imagine Australia in a square, it's at like a ratio of 2 to 1. So it's twice as wide as it is high. Does that make sense?
Okay.
Yep. So I've looked at all these different measurements of Australia, you know, the maximum width, the maximum length, and it's more around a 4-3 ratio. So I'm not finding anything that suggests that it's way wider than it is longer. So is our map actually way, way smaller than what we actually know? Like, is it? It must be way, way deeper.
I would think it would be way bigger. That'd be, you know, judging from some of the stuff that we're seeing in the plane flights in the Southern Hemisphere, I would think it was
and
way
when you
way
look
bigger.
That's right. And if you compare the latitude lines, all the latitude lines on the current flat Earth map are equal.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And if we're suggesting that they get elongated as you go further south, then clearly it's just been actually shrunk, just like the current Mercator map that's just been shrunk in. So there needs to be something else done there. And I was listening on to another podcast, and I can't remember who it was, but one of the callers called up and said that surely you should be able to measure a certain amount of distance on a ship, 10 degrees south and 10 degrees north of the equator. And it should be the same because it's a ball. But you should be able to get some kind of difference in distance on the south.
Right,
and
right.
Maybe you can use that to... Yeah, so maybe you could use that to calculate how far out each latitude or longitude, or maybe you even need to do 10, 20 degrees
maybe.
Further south so you can maybe. See if there's some kind of pattern.
Yeah, it's possible, although somebody wrote me after the show last week and said that Neil deGrasse Tyson may have covered his own butt when he talked about the Earth being sort of pear-shaped, because then below the equator, you know, in the outer ring and the flat map, you would see a slight exaggeration in distance. So, it's a good one. He refused
the pear to being upside down pear. So the north is the bottom of the pear. Is that what he's
referring to? No.
That would make sense if it's elong.
I think he's saying the south is the bottom part of the pair, if I'm not mistaken. I'll have to rewatch it again now, even though I've watched it a bunch of times, and that didn't even occur to me. But I think he said south,
yes.
but I could be wrong.
So. I think there's a bit of BS in Neil deGrasse's idea of the pair. I mean, if he's talking about it like you're suggesting,
yeah.
Then the pair elongates at the top, so it just doesn't make sense anyway.
Yeah, agreed.
But actually, just I wanted to point out, and this will be my last comment, and I'll leave you guys to it.
Okay.
Is you guys were just talking about one of your emails about the space and how can you thrust against nothing when you're in a vacuum.
Mm.
You know, the whole idea of talking about space here, I agree with everything, but if we are in a dome structure, at what point do we become weightless? Is there constantly an atmosphere within the dome, or does it become a form of space where there is a vacuum,
ooh.
Or is it just simply the... is it just the vacancy of nothing? It's just nothing. No
yeah.
particles. How does it work?
Good point.
As you go higher, something has to not be there.
Yeah, excellent point. I would think at the atmosphere would take up the bulk of it, of course. But yeah, there could be a pocket up there that there's really nothing in as far as particles go, possibly. I'm not against it.
That's right. Yeah.
So.
Anyway, that was just all my points I wanted to make. I'll probably call again next week or something else.
Okay.
I'll talk to you soon.
Right on.
All right. Thanks, man. Talk to you soon.
Yes, see you.
Okay.
And by the way, I was tracing that call as he was talking.
Oh, we can't task a drone strike that far, man.
No, but it
takes like 48 hours for something international like that.
No, but it was actually going through the sixth floor of the Texas School Book Depository. Believe it or not.
This is why I love you. You got the best references. Because then I don't see them coming. You know, I think you're going to use a cliche and you never do. I use the cliches.
We got another call.
Well, wait. Before you bring him on, did he just show up?
Yeah, we'll wait.
Okay, let's wait because I have one more. Because I want to tie it to this email to that guy. Because that guy was, that was Australia, right? Yeah.
Yeah.
This guy wrote from New Zealand. And he says, hey, Mark, just watched your presentation. Actually, I watched it 5 times and then showed it to my partner. It has opened up a truckload of questions, but also gone one step closer to making the jigsaw puzzle a little clearer. We are both university grads working in IT, clear-minded, but also open-minded, and both seeking the truth. I have long held the belief that the world we live in is more like the Matrix than we realize, and that the world has been pulled over our eyes. Ever since I looked into the death of Princess Diana and discovered a massive conspiracy and just the depths of it reached, and since 2002, I have spent nearly every day collating information on all areas, the government, NASA, the royals, religion, education, health, and seeing a recurring picture forming of cover-ups, world domination, etc. But your videos and the Flat Earth clues has made me think twice about everything again, which I already knew it would. What I am interested in is knowing more and finding out what you have discovered, as I suspect that the information you have given is just the tip of the iceberg. We're through the looking glass here, people. I just added that. Have you a list of resources I can start looking into? Is there a decent site I can join that will put me in touch with people like yourself? As much as I believe a lot of truthers out there also exist, a lot of the aluminum foil brigade who do the movement a lot of damage and loss of credibility. Please, as there's too much infighting and it has to stop if we are to win the fight and put things right. So yeah, there's a couple different places you could go to I recommend for other resources. One is a playlist I created on my channel. called Flat Earth Shortlist. It's about 23, 24 videos long. It's Sanity is Sanity has made a website. I can't remember the name of it right off the top of my head, where you can go and look at other people's evidence. I don't know how far along he is with it because I've been really busy. Rob Skiba's website called testingtheglobe.com. Check that out. Or again, honestly, just go into YouTube, type in Flat Earth and set the filter to this year. You will just get a tidal wave of information that's out there. A lot of it's very, very good. And, you know, just keep the fight going. So thank you, Paul from New Zealand.
Excellent.
Do we have a call, and where are they calling from?
I think they're calling from Canada, but who knows where they're routing from.
Oh, Canada.
I think they're
on. Excellent. You're reading. Beautiful. Calling from Toronto, guys.
Toronto.
Hey, what's going on?
What's going on?
Listen, I won't keep you. You guys, I love your show. I needed a new drug, and I found it in Truth Frequency, so keep up the good work. I'm hooked for life. Couple things real quick. Living in Toronto, I can see Hamilton. I'm in the Golden Horseshoe. That's like 32 nautical miles, 37 miles across. I can see it clear as a bell. Another thing, can someone explain correction lines all those years in Alberta running roads north and south, and every now and then you'd make a quick jog to one way for a couple hundred yards, and then you'd head off to the right in another direction. Mm-hmm. The correction lines, what the hell are these for? As well, it's to align the roads so they don't collide when they reach the equator. I always bought that.
Wow.
Could you explain, like, geographically, or why do they have these things called correction lines on roads that run north and south in the middle of nowhere for no reason?
In fact, that's the first time I even heard that term. I'm going to have to look it up and talk to my survey friend who shot
Sorry, I don't know the answer to that, but I never even questioned it until, when I'm driving out there and I come across it, like, yeah, you turn left at the correction line without ever thinking of anything other than it's just a line to correct the, it'll come up again, I'm sure. Another thing real quick, Greg Carlson, he had someone on a few weeks ago that was talking about, he has a theory that NASA's running another scam, that the whole Mars lunar orbit, those toys are rolling around on a barren island in northern Canada. And I'm finding that really not too difficult to believe. They got pictures of little moles that live up there and old railroad ties that may have drifted in from, you know, like pieces of wood and flotsam.
Yeah.
And you can't get there. And it falls into the dome theory. And I don't know, guys. Like, you give me a lot to think about. In my job, I got nothing more to really do than think, so... Thanks for blowing my mind.
Where did you say you were situated? You could see across a bay at about 30?
No, I'm in Toronto, and I walk my dog. I live at the beach in Toronto, and I walk my dog. And over the years, I've just actually come home over the years, and I'm looking across the lake. It's called the Golden Horseshoe. It's like if you follow along the lake, you'll come to Niagara Falls, you get Hamilton, then Niagara Falls, and you'll swing around to Rochester. So... Since I've been away, I'd never realized that Hamilton, which is, it's 37 miles across the lake. It's actually,
that's 59 kilometers.
Across,
yeah.
I said to a stranger, I says, "Is that Rochester?" He says, "No, man, that's Hamilton." I says, "Holy shit, Hamilton! I mean, I've been away that long, and you can see the entire skyline." It just kind of blew me away, and I thought, yeah, it just makes sense. And I'm looking, and I said, does that lake line look straight to you? And he says, oh, it's got a curve to it. And I thought, well, it's a complete stranger. I don't know this guy, but he's seeing something different than what I'm seeing.
Yeah.
And I thought, well, it's... Anyway, on the correction line, no answer. The Carlwood thing is fascinating because it's... I zeroed in on the island, and it is kind of... kind of mysterious, you know?
Interesting.
Interesting
stuff.
Yeah, so anyway, keep up the good work. I love your show, and I won't take any more of your time, so I'll say goodnight. Thanks, guys.
Hey, you have a good one. See you later, Toronto. On that note, do we have any more? Can I read something?
No, we're good.
Cool. There is, you remember the guy that made the Flat Earth Frisbees, John, not going to work here anymore.
I always give him a hard time, every email he sends.
Rapaciolo, R-A-P-A-C-C-I-U-O-L-O. Rapaciolo, whatever, it doesn't really matter. Anyway, he's making Flat Earth mouse pads now.
Oh, cool.
Flat Earth mouse pads, check it out on Kickstarter.com. We'll be back.
Enemy Within Radio with Tom Barnes. Saturday on Truth Frequency Radio.
Welcome back to Strange World, segment four, the last segment. And that was Joe Jackson, Stepping Out.
I love that song.
I know. I love it too. I know it's kind of light and fluffy, but it's a great track. I just really dug it.
The other one too, by the way, Harry Nilsson. That show was on again, that movie Goodfellas the other night.
Goodfellas, yeah. That's a great track. I didn't know that song even existed until Goodfellas.
Yeah.
I thought it was great. Well, I mean, it's a little before me. So it was cool. Number to call in to talk to Jonathan and myself is 866. That's toll free. 866-37-TRUTH or 866-378-7884. What?
Nobody calls to talk to me. It's always, hey, Mark. And then no, this weird pause.
That's not true. Oh, hey, Jonathan. like Jonathan's just sitting over in the corner eating a sandwich.
I'm sorry.
It's not true. That's not true. You were such a huge wealth of information for me that I'm just the dancing monkey in a lot of cases. So, or as I like to call myself, a dancing Shrek. Because every time I hate to say this, but every time I do like a video show, and you know what show I do, I can't even watch the video. I look at myself. It's like, why do people even stay in the same room with me?
What do you mean?
I don't know. I just don't consider myself photogenic in any way, shape, or form. I come off as this big dork. My mother even told me the other day. She's going. She goes. I go. What? I go. What do you see when you see me on camera? And she goes, a dork.
I go. Wow. She said that.
Yeah. And I go, you're supposed to be supportive. What kind of mother are you? And then she'd say, I think your hairline just moved.
It's like, oh, you know what? It's the lighting. It's the lighting.
Yeah, it is probably the lighting.
I always tell pretty girls, I was like, you know, you take the prettiest girl, and if you turn out the lights, put a flashlight under her face, she's going to be scary looking.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So it's like, yeah, if you backlight yourself and then you just move the camera a little bit, you could look like Big Brother. I mean, you could look intimidating.
Well, you saw my my tactical outfit.
Yeah.
The other day. So yeah, I thought that was pretty fun, even though that wasn't a costume.
But you need to do like a forced perspective so you look really big, like ginormous. Like put the webcam down on the desk and then look down at it.
Oh, that's great. I should do that next time.
Yeah.
That's totally cool. Okay. Real quick, because I'm waiting for people to call, and I'm trying to burn through some of these emails. Here's real quick. Hi, Mark. For me, this world never felt right. I was investigating quantum physics, string theory, and reality itself. I'm not a physicist. That's why I watched every YouTube lecture and documentary about these topics. YouTube is full of interesting theories. I spend lots of time watching them, and I mean lots, hundreds of hours. Also, I watched all kinds of spiritual guru videos about ego and consciousness. I always try to see the bigger picture. At some point, I realized that we lived in some sort of computer-generated simulation. And then I had an idea. If we really are in the computer, then the flow of information where it meets the consciousness must be two-dimensional. And the third dimension is just an illusion product of decoding. for as it's the world we see around us. For this to be true, the world needed to be flat. I did the research for Flat Earth, and I was shocked because I didn't expect much, but there it was. Next 2 or 3 weeks, I didn't sleep much. I hear that a lot from people, by the way. Last 7 months, I was so into Flat Earth that I've seen almost every video there is. I don't know about that. Maybe you did, though. I think that you, with a gaming background, will agree that it's possible for as to be playing just a multiplayer game. And then thanks. And he was writing from Latvia. His name's, I can't even, Carlos Lagzindins. So
if he's listening, I don't want to give it away just yet because I'm under strict orders.
You're killing me. Go ahead.
But like we exist in a third, fourth dimension. Everybody says the third dimension. Fourth is time. It's a component of this dimension. And so you have your XYZ axis, you have the constant of light, you have gravity. I mean, light even changes when you shoot it down a tunnel and then it trails off into a shadow. You know how it has gradients of light?
Yeah.
It's thought that it's even slower as it goes down the tunnel. You know, like an open tube. So what I'm getting at is I don't want to reintroduce the curve into things because people will get confused.
Yeah.
But you know how you cast shadows with light and how you can take an object like a tube, for example. If you take a round cardboard tube, an empty paper towel tube, and you hit it from one side, it'll look rectangular as a shadow on the wall.
Yeah.
It won't look curved.
You're right.
Right?
Yeah.
So that, I don't want to give too much into it, but kind of like what that guy said. Let me just put out this last thing. Our mind is a big component to this, and that's why it is so freaking critical for the powers that be, the Illuminati, to control our minds and to keep it with all the distraction and misinformation.
Yeah.
Because when people marvel at other people's work, they read a book or they hear about a guru and all this, the one thing they forget is that that person that they're admiring – or holding up there on a pedestal like a hero, is only processing everything through their body the same equipment that you or I have. It's just a matter of accessing it.
Wow.
Do you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So it's kind of like, imagine, I'll put it in another simpler way real quick. Imagine if we were all radio tuners, which we are. We tune into different frequencies, just like this radio station or just like AM, FM. It's just a matter of what you dial into.
Okay.
So if you go inward and you get quiet and you do certain meditative practices, you'll tune in one way. If you pray and you do an exterior – I'm saying there's all different access points. But what happens is when you use your brain as the receiver that it is, it's not just a it's a transmitter and receiver. It starts to affect things on a dimensional level. It operates on a dimensional level, and that's all I'm permitted to say at this time.
It's these moments which make me really wonder where you actually came from, dude. Seriously.
I'm like that scientist in that movie UHF with Weird Al.
All right. On that note, thank you, Jonathan. For Jonathan from Jersey, Secrets of the Universe. He may know them, but he's not telling.
Not allowed.
I'm just going to throw out a few bread, just throw some scraps on the floor. That is fine. That's totally good. Okay, let's get real quick into it.
Sure.
You and I are going to have to talk one of these days, seriously. This email is from Lee, and Lee writes, he goes, yes, also as an A&P certified technician who started working on aircraft in the Navy on F-14A Tomcats, as an AE, which stands for aviation electrician, and then later going back to school to obtain the A&P certification airframe and power plant, I know that aircraft go through strict calendar and phase inspections. Rivets are inspected for wear, elongated wear of the skin, where rivets fasten skin to ribs and such. Over time, the inspections become more involved to the point where the aircraft is just gutted and skin stripped for non-destructive testing of mainframes. Always around the lavatory, there is a lot of corrosion. This is to help validate your guess that spoke about all the maintenance issues with the ISS. I had not paid attention to any of this before, as I just didn't find it interesting. I was 10 in 69. Oh, I was 10 in 1969. I remember being very disappointed, as it appeared the moon has appeared very fake as to a child. So to my knowledge, the ISS has never been put in dry dock for any kind of maintenance that would absolutely have to be done. and a real airship. Thanks, Lee. Thank you, Lee.
Sweet.
That's excellent. Yeah, that's excellent. Throw out the phone number one more time.
We've got caller, so go ahead and throw it out there.
Oh, wow. Okay. Number to call, toll-free, 866-37-TRUTH or 866-378-7884. Who do we got?
I don't know. Who do we got?
Where are they?
This is Tom from Baltimore, Maryland.
Hey.
What's going on?
How are you gentlemen doing this evening? And by the way, you're both greeted every time I call because I refer to you as gentlemen because I can't remember your names. Is it Mark and Bob?
No.
Wow. You know, Baltimore's not that far away. I'll come down there. Actually, I'm going to visit Sean McCreary next week, so you just send me your address to Perceptions Talk Radio, and I'll come pay you a visit.
Ooh.
You'll never forget my name again.
I see a sparrow missile in this guy's future. And I'm not even psychic.
I'm an old retired disabled cop, and I still have my service weapon. So I think if I can get my eyes to focus right, I might be able to pick you off before you actually get up here.
I was just going to take you out for root beer. I didn't mean to get all violent. I just meant let's go have a root beer.
I thought you were coming to, you know, pound in your name to my skull. I mean, that's, you know, when you grow up in a lifestyle where everybody in the family's in the military or with the police, I guess, you know, you add Irish to that. And, you know, it's just kind of in our blood. By the way, speaking of violence, you know, the face issue you were talking about, being able to intimidate someone with an ugly face, that's actually a major factor in bare knuckle boxing or any kind of fighting for that matter. In fact, if anyone's listening who's ever been trained in serious self-defense where your life is on the line, or even if you're, I guess, if you're just competing, I imagine they would train the same way, but we're trained to do something called ghosting, and that is to not ever focus on the face. In fact, there's a way you can actually kind of blur the face of your opponent because it can actually affect you in a physical way that you really can't control. So if you ghost the face, it makes your opponent that much less intimidating, and it actually ups your odds of winning a confrontation by, you know, a little bit, and every little bit counts when, you know, it's a life or death situation. What I wanted to tell you guys, though, is that congratulations, the website actually reflects the proper time. But I noticed that during the day, your plug advertising the show comes on, and it's still directing people to Saturday night. I thought you might want to know that.
Oh, you know what? Thank you. Thank you very much. I've been meaning to get that changed. I will have that graphic changed real, real shortly. Sorry about that. I've been uploading stuff so fast that I forgot that it's actually still showing people, pointing people to Saturday. Good point.
Yeah, I think your radio spot says it too.
Yeah, no, I just wanted to let you know so you could, you know, help yourself out because that might be why you're. Yeah, I'm sure you got plenty of people listening, but, you know, you probably have others that go to Saturday and say, you know, well, what is this? Or maybe they think, you know, that time slot is you, and they rotate that time slot so they could be listening to anything and thinking, I'm not into the show, and not even realizing they're not listening to the right show.
Good point.
Hey, have you guys heard about years ago, a guy who gained popularity as a supposed time traveler, John Teeter.
John Teeter, yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
Do you remember him? Yeah. You know, it never ceases to amaze me. Yeah, I always thought it was a bunch of bunk. But for some reason, his chat sessions, which were published, were hardly enthralling. It would just kind of draw you in. And I'm not one really to stick with something and read it unless it really has my attention. Mm-hmm. And other people were reporting the same type of thing. And a lot of people stopped believing that there was any possibility of it being even remotely true after some of the predictions actually didn't come true. However, the one thing he did say, if you remember, was you could never actually get back to the exact timeline. In other words, the Rosenthal Bridge theory, he was kind of saying that's not true, that really when you branch off, if, and of course you have to believe that time travel is actually possible. Of course, we know that going forward is possible from Einstein. It's the going back thing that we're not sure of. And he says, you know, the bridge theory, that isn't true, that there's just an infinite number of pathways that you can take. And getting back to where you came from is always off by just a little bit. And that would have accounted for his predictions being off. And if you go back and read what he predicted, he really was pretty spot on, but he was off by a couple years. I remember, because I just heard this the other day, someone said, you know, about that, they were speculating about that missile in Los Angeles, California, or wherever it was in California that people saw. I maybe took credit for it, and they were speculating that maybe it wasn't ours, that maybe it was China's or Russians that did it, kind of as a warning, just a shot over the bow. And one of the things that Teeter had always predicted was a big issue with guns. He said that was going to tear the country apart. People who wanted to get rid of guns in the Second Amendment and those who didn't. And he also said that ultimately it would be Russia who, he said, I know, you know, they're your big enemy, you think, but it'll be the Russians who actually liberate America. There will be a war. However, they're going to only attack major cities, and ultimately that will give the people the right to get back a constitutional government. And, well, not the right, because we certainly have the right, but it'll give them the opportunity, because it'll cripple the power structure that's in place. And I just thought that was interesting, and I wanted to get your opinion on it.
As far as Russia being the cause of what's coming down the pipe?
Well, or the, as far as what he predicted, they would be the liberators. In other words, you know, this country would continue down the path that it's on, stripping people of their God-given rights. Yeah. And the people won't be able to mount any type of real resistance. And I can kind of see that. People just, you know, mainly wouldn't be able to get organized in a proper way with proper military discipline to do anything. And the government's gotten so big. And what he said was ultimately there would be a war, and the main power structure would be crippled by an attack by Russia, but they wouldn't want to take over the country because it would just be too much. They would be smarter, he said, than Americans who took over places like Iraq and then just didn't have the manpower to properly control it. And he said that would be the break that the American people needed to go ahead and take back the government.
Gotcha. For me, it's always been, you know, I was, you know, growing up in the 80s, I was big on, you know, believing the whole Cold War and that Russia was our enemy and that, you know, better dead than red, that whole thing. But then the more I dug into the theory recently, especially with Flat Earth, you know, it makes me go down the path that Russia has been, you know, our secret brother this entire time. That they've been our ally for the longest time, going all the way back to the Civil War, and then afterwards selling us Alaska, and then, you know, the fact we've never squared off officially in any major skirmish anywhere, at least not publicly. So it's tough for me to, you know, to think that Russia would be. I mean, yeah, maybe in that guy's time traveling world, maybe it happened, like in an alternate version. Also, you know, he could have, another time traveler could have run into the part where Germany won the Second World War and then ended up taking over the entire world. But where we are now, nah, I don't see Russia doing it. I mean, they may posture a few times, but anyway, thank you very much for calling in. One more, we've got a few more times. I want to read this quick email from it's called Flat Earth Newfoundland, and it says, hello Mark, I heard you on Coast to Coast. And that was I Had to Know More. You know how it goes. I'm hooked. All my friends think I'm crazy, but not my wife. You see, she is from a small town in Newfoundland. She always told me about how all the famous people would stop in an airport close to her town in Gander, Newfoundland. It was always in their small town papers that all kinds of major people, movie stars, presidents, foreign leaders would be stopping for fuel and sometimes a stayover. She always said her dad told her it was because they were the center of the earth. We always laughed at that cute saying, but when I told her about Flat Earth, it all fit in. So lucky for me, my wife is now on board. We can be crazy together. Just thought you might like to look at that. Aw, isn't that nice? That Flat Earth love. Honestly, it's tough to find couples. You know, you're lucky that Melissa's on board, for example.
Yeah.
So that's great. So thank you. Thank you, Kelly from Newfoundland. So that's great. Go ahead.
No, I was just thinking about what he said about John Teeter, Titer. Depends on how you say it.
Yeah.
The thing about time travel is you can't start that timeline or those paradoxes until you actually start the machine. Like in the movie, they always show it like Terminator, you know, it happens in the future and they know an exact point of when the whole thing started.
Yeah.
But like I told you about the exercise, right? There's an exercise you can do that you can start your own time machine.
Yeah.
Did I talk to you about that off?
I think you did, but go ahead.
You want to know it now?
Well, how long will it take?
1 minute.
Okay, go.
Basically, and you start this tonight if you want. You start broadcasting. You sit in a place. You pick a designated time. Try to do it every day. Try to make the location the same every day, bedroom, wherever. It just helps with X, Y, Z coordinates until later. And so what you do is you sit in a receptive mode for 5 minutes and you focus on the future at the same time the next day, but you do it for 5 minutes ahead from when you're sitting. And you sit there and you wait for 5 minutes. And then you project to the day before for 5 minutes in the same manner and picture in your mind's eye the same spot, same day, and so on. Now, a lot of people say, well, I didn't do it yesterday. No kidding. But you got to start the damn time machine in order to get the thing going. That's how time travel works.
Nice.
Because what people get confused with is they say, well, I didn't do it yesterday. They say, yeah, but that's the linear time track that you're on. Time travel works on the percent, you know, and the idea that you're creating parallels, you're jumping tangents. It's almost like guitar strings that are next to each other. You pluck one, the other one resonates.
Yeah.
Again, I can't give out all the information, but what I'm saying is if you start, there's a lot I got to tell you yet, man. I got to wait.
I know.
It's all about jump points.
Yep.
Anyway, if you start doing this, what happens is you start to get information from yourself. And then once you get it, get used to it on a day-to-day basis, you can do a second part, more advanced technique, where you project further out months, years, even like 5 years, 10 years, whatever parameter you want to set. And then you build this time loop. But it's just about starting the machine and it's within you. And that's all I can say.
That's outstanding, man.
Cool.
That's really great. Simone, let's jump quick into the mailbag. We got a few minutes left before the end of the show. And thank you, everyone who's listening now. Really appreciate it. This one's from Simone. And Simone wrote this to a bunch of people, but I'd thought you'd bring it up. She said, I found this comment in the comment section of Mark's channel. Maybe something you can do a clip. Apollo 13, like the only movie about moon trips. So as it was on TV last night, I thought I should watch it to see if the Flat Earth presented somewhere through it. And it is on the clock, the same Flat Earth clock at the start of Back to the Future. That's what she thought anyway. It's about 20 minutes in the way through the movie where they are at the office, the NASA office, and the guy who she misidentified the actor. But that's okay. So I actually looked at it. I downloaded Apollo 13 and went, you know, scanned that whole section from 20 minutes to 28 minutes. And it's actually at 20 minutes and 30 seconds. And I think I showed you on the back of the desk behind the guy who's sitting down, behind the guy in the white shirt, there is a white clock with a map on it. And at first glance, it looks just like the clock from Back to the Future, the actual Flat Earth clock from Back to the Future. Mm-hmm. However, if you zoom in on it, it's you'll look real close. It's actually not. It's actually a Mercator map. So she was close. It was really good. Honestly, it's like, really, how many white clocks with a map on it, you know, could there be? But it was interesting. So close, almost there. Keep looking. Again, the internet hive mind, they miss nothing. Yeah. So, yeah.
I know we're coming down to the end of it, but you have one more caller. You want to just say hi?
Sure. Shoot. What do you got?
All right. Caller, you're on the air.
Where's it from?
I think Michigan.
Michigan.
Hey, guys. How you doing?
Good. What's going on?
Yeah. Chris from Michigan calling from L.A., actually.
Okay. What's up?
Yeah, I'm down here for work doing the auto show. So I was just listening to that the guy earlier that was talking about degrees of plumb, like per mile, you know, how many degrees it would be on a level or whatever. So if you got your plumb here, you go so many miles, how many degrees off is plumb?
Right.
So I figured, you know, if it's Google says the Earth is, what, 24,901 miles circumference?
Yeah,
give or take a mile.
So I figured if you divided that, exactly. So you divide that by four, and then you divide that number, you divide 90 by that number, which that number was 6225.25. 90 divided by that equals 0.014, and so on, degrees per mile, which works out to about 69.169 miles per degree.
Excellent.
That was something I was kind of curious about too, because I actually I don't get to travel across the country too often, so I kind of got up the attitude instrument app on my phone and ran that on the plane, and came out to, there was like a little bit of roll when I landed in LA.
Hate to do this to you, man, but we're wrapping up the show. So, but thank you very much for the calculations. Okay. And we will have people double check that math.
Call back on the next show. Definitely.
Yeah. Call back on the next show. Okay. And as
we appreciate it, guys.
No worries. And as we're wrapping up in the last 30 seconds, I just want to say thank you to Jonathan for helping out with everything that you do. Very much appreciated. Thank you to Joshua Stargaze, who sent me a whole bunch of cool pictures, and David Weiss for keeping up the fight. And we'll see you guys next time.
See you soon.
Function. hooking up words and phrases and clauses in complex sentences like, in the mornings when I'm usually wide awake, I love to take a walk through the gardens and down by the lake, where I often see a duck and a drake. And I wonder as I walk by just what they'd say if they could speak. Although I know that's an absurd thought.
Conjunction, what's your function?
Hooking up cars and making them function.
Conjunction, junction, how's that function?
I like tying up words and phrases and clauses.
Conjunction, junction, watch that function.
I'm gonna get you there if you're very careful.
Conjunction, junction, what's your function?
I'm going to get you there if you're very careful.
Conjunction, junction, what's your function?
I'm going to get you there.